أتقدم نيابة عن نفسي وعن الأساتذة المحترمين وعن الشركات المنظمة بالترحم على شهداء العمل الطبي في مصر وزملائنا وزملاء المهنة الذين قضوا حياتهم في دفاعهم عن المرضى ومتابعة عملهم بإخلاص وجد. وأدعو الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يتغمدهم برحمته، وأدعو الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يشفي جميع المرضى ويزيل عنا الوباء والبلاء. اسمحوا لي بداية أن أتقدم بخالص الشكر لزملائنا، على رأس القائمة الأستاذة الدكتورة جيهان العسال، أستاذ الأمراض الصدرية بجامعة عين شمس، وأستاذنا الكبير الدكتور أحمد جزار، عميد كلية الطب بنها سابقا وأستاذ الصدر بجامعة بنها، وزميلي المحترم الأستاذ الدكتور أحمد يوسف، أستاذ ورئيس قسم الصدر بجامعة الإسكندرية، هو زميلي ودفعتي طبعا أيضا وأنا فخور به، والأخ زميل المحترم الآخر دفعتي برضو الأستاذ الدكتور ياسر نعمان، أستاذ الصدر والعناية المركزة بلندن، وزميلي الأستاذ الدكتور محمود الخلاني أخصائي التغذير بمانشستر، ومعكم سعد مهدي. نيابة عنكم أشكر الشركة المنظمة.
وشفت بقى آخر حبيب وأخويا الغالي الأستاذ الدكتور ياسر نعمان. دكتور ياسر نعمان الميزة اللي فيه اللي هو لغاية دلوقتي هو أستاذ معانا في جامعة اسكندرية، كلية طب جامعة اسكندرية في الكريتيكال كير، وفي نفس الوقت هو أستاذ في جامعة سويس إند في إنجلترا. بص بقى دكتور ياسر، انا حضرتك سمعت بقى الجورني الجميله بتاعت الفيروس كلها والاودينس بتاعنا، في نفس الوقت البروتوكول الايجيبشن. انا عايز حضرتك برضو تقول لي بقى الجورني بتاعت اللي عايزين نربط بقى الحكايه دي، الجورني من اول ما بيدخل المريض بيتعمل له ايه لغايه ما في النهايه بيروح الورد او يروح الاي سي يو وبعد كده ديستشارج ات هوم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. It's my honor to be invited to such a great scientific activity. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, Dr. Ahmed, and Dr. Saad and Dr. Jihan for excellent presentations. So first, I would like to, in the next 25 minutes, as presented by my colleague, Dr. Ahmed, that we are going to go through the journey of the patient, of the COVID-19 patients admitted at a UK hospital. We are, alhamdulillah, the peak in the UK now have subsided. Inshallah, Masr and all the rest of the world, biiznillah, we see that it's subsiding completely. But it's good to share our experience and to listen to other countries' protocol who have been through the difficult time. My first message is the teamwork. We have been through a difficult time, and as frontliners, I'm sure that all my colleagues, especially the junior ones, are going through a difficult time. The most important thing here is always to remember, this is an example of the community support, where all the people coming to our hospital, near our hospital, they were really supporting us, and you might have heard about the clapping, which was done every Thursday at 8 o'clock, which I feel it was a great support, and it was making us feel that the community is appreciating our work. So my advice to our junior colleague there in Egypt during this difficult time, support each other, teamwork, as we had in our hospital South End. I would like to thank them all. And this is like putting all our names in a nice artistic picture, which is making us feel support. So it's a big thank you to the teamwork at South End, but also it's a big thank you to the critical team in Alexandria University. We have been kept in touch during this pandemic all the time with my colleague there, and a great appreciation to our professors in Alexandria University, critical care medicine and anesthesia. So now we are going to start the how the patients were presenting. My colleagues have, my professors here have already touched base about this, presenting symptoms, the respiratory symptoms, which are mainly like something like sore throat, difficulty in breathing, but be aware about this silent happy hypoxemia. Some of the patients, as Dr. Gazzar has mentioned, they have got low oxygen saturation, and they are not giving you any symptoms at all. So it's not only about the symptoms of the patients. Some of them will be presenting with enteric manifestation, like such as vomiting and diarrhea. Some people come with systemic manifestation, fever, myalgia, and others. It's in our mind, and we need always to think about when we have any patient suspecting COVID-19, is the hematological, especially the venous thromboembolism. Cardiac, we have seen some patients coming with ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarctions, and even strokes. The neuro and psychiatric manifestations are so common with the COVID. It's not something that we have seen with other types of influenza, and the pathophysiology has been already covered by our professor, Dr. Ahmed Ghazar. Strangely enough, it's not only venous. It's some patients are coming with arterial thromboses. This is a gentleman who came to our hospital here. He's 64 years old. He came with breathlessness, and he had a collapse on the 29th of April. He also complained of left upper limb pain for 3 days. The left arm was completely cold. We couldn't feel the radial pulse. And he didn't have any sensation in it. His oxygen saturation was 98% on 2 liters per minute. The D dimer, and here Professor Jihan, I'd be a little bit in disagreement with what you mentioned about the importance of the blood tests here. The D-dimer, will come back to it now. This guy, he came with 9,500. We have been seeing numbers we have never seen before with the plasma D-dimers for these patients. The lymphocytic count was 1.05, and the chest X-ray was the classic COVID-19. So we requested a CTPA and CT angio of the left upper limb. It has shown the large acute embolus in the left brachial artery, and it was actually extending down to the radial artery with no palmar arch vessel enhancement. There was massive pulmonary embolism with right ventricular strain as well, and plus the moderate and severe classic COVID-19, which we have already seen on the chest X-ray. So the CT scan here was mainly for the thromboembolism. We have thrombolyzed this gentleman and followed by IV heparin, and then changed after this to the rivaroxaban. The swab, we don't obviously wait for the swab, but they came positive 4 days later. And then the following day, he was already ready to be discharged on the DUAC, the rivaroxaban, for 3 months to be reviewed, as we will see in our follow-up appointments and follow-up plan. His oxygen saturation was 95% on air. And us as a team, every single patient who's leaving our hospital after being so critically with the COVID, we were in two rows clapping and cheering him up. It was a big, big moment. And I should say about the COVID-19, it's actually something fascinating for all of us, because we are learning every day, and we're feeling that it's really important feedback that we are getting when our patients are getting better and alhamdulillah going back home. So this is the thrombolism. How dealing with pandemic? Dealing with pandemic, it's, as I said, we have this opportunity, actually Egypt and the Middle East, where the countries who still have got the peak, have got this opportunity from, it was a good opportunity that it has been peaked in different other countries. And this is how we dealt here with the pandemic. Obviously, protocols has been different in different countries. I'm presenting the UK experience. Mild symptoms pathway. So we do telephone. We had the telephone 111 support for all the patients to call. And then we could advise them over the phone, asking them to stay at home and just having the supportive measures. But there were alarm signs. The nurses answering this telephone consultation, it was very clear when to advise the people to come to hospital. There was a lot of public education in the mainstream media. So people were not relying on, unfortunately, as we see everywhere, on the social media with all the myth and strange things. ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. We read it every day on the social media. But then still may come, many were came, coming to the A&E straight away. On the moderate and severe symptoms pathway, we have got, they come via ambulance service, self-presentation to access emergency, and we needed to deal with making, to deal with this pandemic, to make adaptations to how we are working. And we have provided new protocols on how to deal with this new disease that it was very new for all of us. So the telephone clinic, did it success? Yes, as you can see here in all across the UK, the A&E attendance has reduced significantly due to this successful telephone clinic. And you can see across, it has been nearly halved because we managed to get the people at home with proper advices. Then now we the journey, the patient now has arrived to our A&E. We, our protocol was mainly guided first by the by his symptoms. The first is the mild severity, and those are the one we discharge home with 14 days isolation. But was it only the symptoms? No, obviously. So we needed some guidance. So for those patients, we needed to do for all of them a chest X-ray. We do for all of them a blood test. And this blood test, we have got this COVID panel. And I explain why we needed here to do all the tests that will be important for our management. It's not about prognostic and diagnostic. It's also about having a baseline. And actually, it has guided our treatment in many of our patients. So a mildly raised CRP and with a normal oxygen saturation, a normal chest X-ray, just the usual common symptoms of respiratory, systemic, and enteric that I've just mentioned. And we are specifically, this is very important here, that we are not only guided by the symptoms, but also we are looking specifically for the hematological or venous thromboembolism, or cardiac or neuro and psychiatry presentation as well. Once we have excluded all these, then patients can be discharged home safely for 14 days isolation, if any hydroxychloroquine. Now we come to the moderate severity. Those are the ones that we decide to admit to the ward, for oxygen or without oxygen, depending on their need. And those are the indication for the people to be admitted in the hospital on the wards. So if our CRP is significantly high with an important ratio that we found that it's really important in guiding our treatment is the NLR ratio, which is the neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio and the plasma D-dimers. If they are those numbers, so the blood tests here are also guiding us together with the symptoms and the other points that I'm showing here in my slide. If the patient has got vomiting or diarrhea, so this supposedly he will need some IV fluids to make sure that he doesn't go into acute kidney failure. If the patient is hypoxemic with an oxygen saturation is less than 92%, and this is responding to 0.4 liter per minute. His FiO2 is 0.4%, so meaning 40% oxygen, which is equivalent to 10 liter per minute. This another ratio, so I've just mentioned an important ratio, which is the NL ratio. Now this is another ratio that we are using here, which is the SFR ratio, which is the oxygen saturation related to their FiO2. If it's more than 230, we are happy for him to go to our ward, not to the ITU. If the patient is tachypneic, but again, not severe tachypnea, 24 to 30. If on the chest X-ray, it's a patchy ground glass opacity, it's more than 50%, so we need to admit to the ward as far as his oxygen saturation is responding to the 40% FiO2. Then we come to the, when they come to us in the accident emergency, we label them as severe, needing immediate HDU admission. So one of those that you can see on the screen, multi-organ dysfunction. It has got abnormal liver and renal functions. This is also very important to tell us that now the disease is becoming severe. If the patient is severely hypoxemic, meaning that his oxygen saturation is less than 92% on 40% oxygen, this means that his SFR is less than 230. His systolic blood pressure is low, less than 90 millimeter mercury, or diastolic is less than 60. His tachypneic more than 30, impending signs of impending respiratory exhaustions, or on the chest X-ray, we can see features of ARDS. Those people come to HDU. Just to mention that the previous one, those one, the moderate, they come to the ward, but many of them, they needed to be shifted to the HDU once they meeting one of these criteria. So this is basically the main journey on entry to the hospital. So what are the typical scenarios that we have seen statistically? We noticed that the people coming to the hospital, usually after in average 4 days of developing of symptoms, their average is 72 years old. The hospital admission, they stay with us in the hospital in average 7 days. And actually, once they are meeting those criteria of moderate or severe, the mortality is actually 33%. Obviously, it's more if they are older, if they are male, if they are obese, and of certain ethnicities. What are the comorbidities that we have seen? Chronic cardiac disease associated with the mortality in 29%, diabetes in 19%, chronic respiratory failure in 19%, asthma in 40%, with other renal, liver, METs, hematological, immunocompromised. But unfortunately, in 47% of the mortality, we could not identify any comorbidities. How many of the hospitalized patients have been admitted to the HDU or the ICU? 17%. That's a big number as if we compare it to something like the influenza or other types of viral pneumonias. I think we had a success story, and the reason for the success story in our hospital was my own passion with the non-invasive ventilation, as my colleague and my dearest friend Ahmed Youssef has mentioned. Once I came here to the UK, I was fascinated by the non-invasive ventilation. We're speaking about 20 years ago, and that's why I found it the shift between the chest medicine, respiratory medicine, and the intensive care, where we have been using the non-invasive ventilation in high-dependency respiratory specialized high-dependency units. So there were NHS guidance, which came in light in March, beginning of April, and each hospital here in the UK has actually interpreted it in a different way. Actually, it's not a different interpretation only, but it's also because they were depending on the resources, something like we're saying the hydroxychloroquine, we have it or do not have it. So this reversion was depending, they do have CPAP machine, what their experience, do they have somebody who is very keen on non-invasive ventilation like myself and my colleagues here at South End Hospital. So those three versions were applied in different ways in different hospitals. And even in our trust here, different hospital has applied it in a different way. It's something fascinating. The version we created here, as I said, was relied on early CPAP in the COVID-19 acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. This is before we have all this body of evidence, which came in light later on after we have started this. So as I said, we started it in March, and now we're seeing that that was the right decision. So those guidance here, as I said, why we have chosen this, those are the three types of management that we have seen in different hospital. As I mentioned here in the main part up there, the oxygen saturation, if it's less than 92%, on FI2 of 0.4, meaning that the SFR is less than 230 and the spirit rate is more than 24, we are trying awake proning, and we've tried it in all our patients. And this patient, we decide they are for full escalation or not. So we have got this three pathway. Our hospital has chosen the right one. I mean, the right of the screen, and I think also it was the right decision as well. So on the right of screen, you have seen any patient with this criteria, we started him very early on the CPAP machine, 10 centimeter water with an FiO2 of 60%. And if this fails, only then we go for invasive mechanical ventilation. In other hospitals, they have chosen the middle one. Immediately, once the patient is hypoxemic, they did not hesitate and they put him on invasive mechanical ventilation, what they call early intubation. This has been suggested by Professor Gattinoni et al. In many papers, saying that if the COVID patient is given the non-invasive ventilation, you are going to induce something called spontaneously induced lung injury, plus the fear of infection for the staff. And that was a lot of discussion, my colleagues, on our WhatsApp group in critical care medicine in Egypt, my friends in Alexandria. We had long, long discussions about this. And I was supporting all the time to be starting the non-invasive ventilation as early as possible. For obvious reason, I have been working with the non-invasive for recruiting more lung units, reducing the work of breathing. And and we saw this very, very clearly later on, avoiding the bad side effects of the invasive intubation and the sedation, which we saw in the COVID patients later on, and we're still suffering from this in our follow-up with our patients. Other hospitals have chosen somewhere in the middle. They did not start the CPAP straight away. They started the non-rebreathing mask, 15 liter per minute. I think in some countries like Saudi Arabia, they are doing this. They are starting the non-rebreathing mask, 15 liter per minute, do not start the CPAP. And this can carry on for 1 or 2 or even 3 days. And once the patient is becoming exhausted and tired, then only then some hospital will put the CPAP. And if the CPAP fails, they go for invasive mechanical ventilation. And in other hospital, they will go straight to the invasive mechanical ventilation without even the trial of CPAP. So why we have chosen this? As I said, we have got a respiratory high dependence unit, very specialized, experienced team, respiratory physician, nurses, physiotherapy, dietitian, salt, physio, psychologist, a great team. And I am very proud of working with this, such a great team. So a teamwork means success. And this setting allowed us to apply the guidelines as per our resources. This is one of the machines that we have used for the CPAP. It's very important if you look to the left and the right that we managed by using the CPAP mask, the tight fitting on the face to reduce the incidence of infection. I know that some people have used the helmet, some people have used the OptiFlow, which is a high flow nasal cannula, but we felt that using a well-tight facial mask like this, together with what we call one limb ventilation and a double viral filter. There is one here, as you see on the left, which is just immediately after the therapy valve filter. And there is another one on the safety valve to make sure that we are not exposing our staff to any incidence of spread of the droplets. We have been promised that we are going to get more ventilators, but unfortunately, during the pandemic, they told us that the machine is going to be delivered in 6 weeks' time. So we needed to use our NIPI 3 Plus on the CPAP mode, but also with a well-fitting facial mask and two filter. As you can see, there is double viral filters. Okay, so what happened and supported our decision? So over the UK, till the end of May, there were 8,533 patients who were admitted to the intensive care and the high dependency unit. 42.4 of them died in the critical care, While if you remember, for the last 3 years in 2017, 18, and 19, there were the viral pneumonias were causing only a 21% mortality for the ICU HDU patients. The patient, if the patient is less than 50, his mortality rate is 20%. If he's between 50 and 60, the mortality goes up to 36%. 60 to 70, it's 50%. And if the patient, your patient is more than 70 years old, you have got a mortality of 62% if he goes to the intensive care. He's male, 74.5% of our intensive care patients were male. The invasive, once you start the invasive mechanical ventilation, your mortality is 51.3%. This happened in over the UK in 72% of the patients who were admitted to the ICU HDU. Others were admitted for other reasons like renal dialysis and so on. The non-invasive ventilation was 27.6, and look, the mortality rate here is only 20%. So this is supporting what we have been doing. If the patient needed renal support, and there were 25% of people who went to the ICU, their mortality was 62%. So we developed this algorithm. I'm happy to share my slides with for teaching purpose, but this was the first one we developed back in March, and we applied it on our patients, and these are the results. So among the nearly at the time 570 patients admitted to our hospitalized, we had 16% coming to needing the mechanical ventilation. Out of these 17%, there were 89 patients, 52 out of them, they have had a CPAP trial. And 37% patients, they went immediately to intubation without CPAP trial, and this happened before our protocol. So this is the outcome of our CPAP trial. Here you can see that all the patients who have been for full escalation, they had a CPAP trial which was successful, were all discharged alive. Only a few of them who actually needed to be intubated, and even those who went to the intensive care, they have actually had less mortality than the patients who went to the intensive care without CPAP trial, which completely against to what Gattinoni has mentioned, that putting your patient on a CPAP trial before intubation, you're only delaying and making him more exhausted and having self-induced lung injury. This is absolutely the opposite. So those are the findings of the study. The CPAP trial, if it's selected in the proper people, so you're going to have 100% if you manage to select this type of patient. A higher SFR before and a higher SFR after the CPAP trial, a lower respiratory rate prior to the CPAP, and a lower NLR and a higher PFR. I mentioned this, so SFR meaning the oxygen saturation to the FiO2 ratio and the neutrophil to the lymphocyte ratio. This is the NLR, and the PFR ratio is well known to all our intensivists, the PO2 to the FiO2 ratio. So because of this, we have developed another algorithm, and this is again the other algorithm that I'm happy to share for teaching purpose. Okay. Now we come to the medications, what Professor Jihan has mentioned. We have been, I would say, a little bit unfortunate here in the UK that we had not have all those trials done before. So I'm happy that in Egypt you have got the benefit of looking to all the results of this. What has been in the whole Europe, we have done what you call the recovery trial. The recovery trial was trying to get evidence-based medicine to decide on which medications to give, making it scientifically. Unfortunately, lots and lots of medications are coming every single day. Let's try this, let's try that, and then it should be, as you know, very well controlled in a study. And this happened here. As I said, unfortunate. Why I'm saying unfortunate for the UK? Because later on, we knew that you need to tailor, to adjust your medications of your patients according to the patient, not doing like this. Unfortunately, in the influenza, if you remember, I remember back in Egypt when I was treating, we were sending people who are having, for example, a bit of cold. They go to the pharmacy and they are feeling a little bit unwell. They give them a bag. They called it مجموعة البرد. Unfortunately, we cannot do this in the COVID. So that was the COVID trial. We have got the standard arm, which can switch after 48 hours if clinically indicated. We have got an arm one of them was the hydroxychloroquine. I should say that it was stopped prematurely because there was a strong evidence after 100, we're speaking about 96,000 patients involved, it was stopped prematurely due to, number one, there is a lack of efficacy and there is side effects of the hydroxychloroquine. This is, by the way, is a different study from the one done, which was published in The Lancet. We just got the email from the recovery trial a couple of days ago asking us the hydroxychloroquine also should be stopped on our trial. The azithromycin, and it's only covering concomitant bacterial. If you are lucky, you have got this. The dexamethasone, that has been completed to full recruitment in the recovery trial. The tocilizumab, I would say, the tocilizumab, it was a randomized trial, so it was started, and when I disagree with Dr. Professor Jehan. There is a little bit of difference in the protocol. The tocilizumab, if you start it early, we see better results. But you start it early when indicated, when you see starting signs of the pro-inflammatory and the cytokine storm. Do not start. You can give with the steroids, but especially if you have got ARDS, but do not delay your immunosuppressive medications, because by that time, by the way, your viremia has already reduced to a low level and you have got a very high immunity in your body. If anything, it's too much. We found also the anakinra, which is not as expensive as the tocilizumab, but it's still very effective. We had an arm with the lopinavir and the ritonavir, but now we feel this has been replaced with the remdesivir, which we found stronger evidence to be used in the antiviral. So let's explain. This is a recovery trial which was done completely blind and completely randomized, not in our hand. We should have had, and this is the advice, is to try the medications according to your patients. You have got three types of patients which need three different types of medications. Number one, if your patient is still in the viremic state, so the remdesivir is a good option. If your patient is already starting signs of the cytokine storm, and by the way, that's why you need your ferritin, you need your oxygen saturation to diagnose whether your patient is starting having this with the inflammatory markers creeping up. So you do a baseline and then to monitor and see whether it's coming up or not. And that's when you start your tocilizumab and the steroid. You need something immunosuppressant in this scenario. Do not wait. Then if you have got a patient who have got a concomitant bacterial infection as evidenced by high NLR ratio, the azithromycin or other antibiotics should be given. So this not the recovery trial. I'm speaking about here. Don't forget the coagulopathy. My colleagues have already mentioned this. I do not need to say it again, but the normal dose of anticoagulation is failing and anticoagulation is improving the clinical outcome. Be careful that just giving the low dose anticoagulation is not working. And that's why we are guided by the plasma D-dimers. We have got a protocol here, if you can see it, the depending on the plasma D-dimer more than 1,000, bigger than 1,000, and in other hospital, they are also looking at above 3,000, they would give the full dosage. I'm also happy to share this with my colleagues. We have spoken about this. The last point I want to remind all of you is the neurological complication and psychiatric complication of the COVID-19, 36% in a study and 14% of the admission, 68% on another study on the discharge. Headaches, dizziness, ataxia, seizures, strokes, confusions, agitation, upper motor neuron signs, and there is a few theories of what is the pathophysiology. It's written here in this slide. The MRI has shown a few changes as well that I can happy to share because I need to go because of go a bit quickly here because of the time. This has been. Don't forget that many people are coming out of the hospital with post from the intensive care with post ITU delirium. Again, here I listed the possible pathophysiological mechanisms and the possible causes of this. Following up is very important, and we have developed a protocol of following up all our patients as a holistic approach. And this, we see them on the day of discharge. If you can see, we give them this discharge bundle, and then 2 days we get a telephone call, and then in 2 weeks, again, with the rehabilitation team, 6 weeks we do follow up, then 12 weeks follow up. All this has been also guided by our British Thoracic Society. We are doing a holistic, so we are involving with us the psychiatry, the neurology, the hematology, and all the other team. And two main problem we are looking for is the fibrosis and the VTE from the side of the lung. I would like to thank everyone who has worked with us, and like to thank all of you for listening to me. Thank you very much.
شكرا جزيلا اخي الحبيب الاستاذ الدكتور ياسر نعمان على الاليجنت برزنتيشن وعلى الكومباريزون ما بين البروتوكول في يو كي والبروتوكول الايجيبشن. انا اعتقد يعني فعلا احنا كنا في حالات مايل عندنا لما بدانا في الكليه كنا بنبدا بوذوت هيدروكسيكلوروكين طالما الاكس راي والسي تي فري والساتوريشن كويس قوي. المشكله ان فعلا بعد يومين ثلاثه لما بنلاقي الناس الحراره بتبقى لسه ستيل عاليه والبادي اكس بنبدا لهم تاني نقول له طب هات الهيدروكسيكلوروكين فعلا بيحصل فيه تشينج كويس جدا. هل عشان التشينج في الفيروس مثلا ممكن يكون في يوكي مختلف عننا؟ ميبي. انا شايف برضو المورتاليتي دكتور ياسر عندنا الحمد لله مش كتير, يعني المورتاليتي في غير مثلا في ايطاليا في الحاجات دي كلها, فاكيد برضو في فاريانت زي ما قال الاستاذ دكتور احمد جزار ان فعلا في اختلاف في الفيروس بتاع الاورجانيزم. اكيد
يعني ممكن نرد على النقطه دي لان I totally agree with Professor الجزار in the type of the virus which is present here and there, but also don't forget that the age, the average age in Europe and the average age in the Middle East and in Egypt, mashallah, Egypt is a young population. We're speaking about an average age of 24, 25. Here in Europe we are above 40. We are having different types. And by the way, if you see from my numbers, most of the mortalities which have happened in the elderly, even in their nursing home. We're speaking about nursing home, who are people who are above 90, above 100, and their carer, they transmit. We're speaking about thousands of patients who have been frail with advanced frailty. The one who actually died in the intensive care are only 4,000. So it's only 10%. So the type of the virus, the viral load, and the age population, which is making also a huge difference, in my opinion.
One more point, Dr. Yasser. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation, outstanding, and I'm sure that everybody is enjoying listening to you. And thank you very much. As regards this point, is number one, viral load, age, comorbidities, And actually, when you have somebody who is diabetic, different from somebody who is diabetic and hypertensive, diabetic and hypertensive and the cardiovascular, and the autoimmune disease or whatever. So every...
Ashraf Abdel Halim now is saying effect of smoking. Yeah, Ashraf, smoking also another myth which was in the social media saying that smoking is protective. No, that's wrong. Smoking is definitely causing a higher mortality.
Thank you.
طيب دكتور ياسر احنا استخدمنا السباب على اساس ان الحالات كلها بتبقى تايب 1 ريسبيراتوري فيلير. قابلتوا حالات كان معاهم هايبر كابنيا وبدانا نستخدم لهم الباي باب؟
Yeah, definitely. If you're having a type 2 respiratory failure, the indication is a BiPAP rather than CPAP, and we can we have given patients, and I should say those are mostly the patients who have got a little bit of background of COPD or other or obesity hypoventilation. But if it's only a mild raising of the carbon dioxide, they are actually responding to the CPAP alone. And don't forget that having the non-invasive ventilation, one of the good things is that you can do awake proning while doing it. We in the intensive care, we have been doing proning, but imagine in our area here from three different intensive care with the proning, they were putting them with the left head underneath their head. The three patients came to us with complete neuropraxia of their left arm, and they take long time to recover from this with a lot of physiotherapy. While if you are doing it while the patient, the proning with the patient is still awake, this is a very, very good advantage.
I have a quick question about CPAP, please. So do you think about CPAP as a destination therapy for patients deteriorating with COVID-19? Or you think the higher survival is because they are better than those that will deteriorate further and progress to intubation? And this is why the mortality with CPAP is less than with intubation.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I mean? And we tackled this in our study and looking in the literature. There is a mild difference between the people who have been immediately intubated without CPAP trial because they were a bit sicker. Because this is an important question. Maybe they are getting a better mortality, less mortality, just because they are not as sick as the others.
Yeah, exactly. This is what I'm thinking. Yeah.
However, looking into the data, the difference between both of them was they were more hypoxemic. There was a little bit more of metabolic acidosis. So the bicarb was 20 rather than 25 in average difference between the two. However, the threshold to start immediate intubation with the COVID has changed. You understand? So yes, there are certain people, for example, if somebody coming to you with immediate indication for intubation, he's shocked, he's has got a massive hemorrhage, unstable, obviously you're going to intubate straight away. However, those patients who have been on the verge between the two where you want to intubate, actually we found that those people with the SFR ratio as low as 114, which is actually a very low ratio, and PF ratio as low as 100, those people, we held on them, we did not intubate, and they managed to do better. So yes, they were sicker, the one who intubated, but the question was how sicker? So give them their time on the CPAP and intubate only if it's extremely necessary.
I'm just conscious that some of the audience might get the message wrong and be reluctant to intubate patients when they need intubation, if you know what I mean.
Yes, yes, obviously, yes.
Dr. Yasser, there is another question actually from Dr. Ahmed Tantawi, and he is asking about why ethnic variation, as we saw already, in especially in the medical team in UK, that there is a lot of vulnerable non-British doctors who died or affected much more and much more obvious. And the second question is, what is the role of hemofiltration as a method of cytokine removal?
Okay, all right. So the first question I would ask the first part of it, and the second part I will pass it to Professor Dr. Ahmed Ghazzar. So our first part of it will be regarding the socioeconomic. Definitely, we're having a difference in the black and the non-white community here, where we saw a much higher compared to the previous previous viral endemics, that there were a much higher mortality, and that was the main thing that we thought. However, the numbers are not only because of the socioeconomic, and this is because of the receptors. And I'm sure that Professor Ahmed Ghazzar will be better than me and in covering this part.
Dr. Yasser, yes. As regarding the receptors, and as we said before, angiotensin converting enzyme mainly located in non-ciliated respiratory epithelial cells and type 2 pneumonocyte in the absorptive part of the small intestine and in the nasal mucosa. So responsible for all manifestations of COVID, either anosmia, loss of taste, or diarrhea, or abdominal pains, or chest tightness due to the affections of type 2 pneumonocyte and decreased effect and secretion of surfactant, leading to decreased compliance of the lung.
في معلش كم سؤال كده يا جماعه معلش نرجع تاني لان في الاودينس كتير قوي واسئله كتيره جدا والويبينار فعلا اكتر حاجه هنسال كذا سؤال واللي هو مثلا عنده الاجابه من حضراتكم يتفضل. في سؤال على البلازما تريتمنت ادي واحد, في سؤال على الاكمو ادي اتنين, في على الهاي فلو نزل كانولا, وفي هل الناس اللي جالهم كورونا ممكن يجي لهم ريلابس بعد الريكفري ولا لا؟ يبقى دول اربع اسئله نبدا باجابتهم ونشوف الاسئله الثانيه بعديهم. اتفضل. طب دكتور جيهان في اي سؤال من دول مع حضرتك؟
انا ممكن اجاوب بس انت عايز, انا ممكن ابتدي باوي سؤال باخر سؤال اللي هو الريلابس. أوكي. الحقيقه ما فيش ريكورد حالات ري انفكشن لغايه دلوقتي, بس احنا ستيل مش عارفين هي فور لايف immunity ولا هتستمر مثلا لغاية سنة جاية زي بعض أنواع الانفلونزا فيروس. حضرتك عارف بتدي immunity لمدة سنة, لكن ممكن يحصل mutation ويبقى ال patient reinfected بعد سنة تاني, لكن actually لغاية دلوقتي ما فيش recorded أو مش recorded حالات reinfection.
طب دكتور ياسر ال role of ECMO هاي فلو نزل كانيولا.
التعليق بس ان هو بالنسبه للري انفكشن احنا في هتلاقوا في ريبورتس جايه ان هو ذا سواب كان باك نيجاتيف اند سو اتس بوزيتيف نيجاتيف اند ذن بوزيتيف اجين. احنا عارفين ان في 30% فولس نيجاتيف. So all the, انا متابع زي ما قال الدكتوره جيهان, يعني don't be misled by those reports. Till now we don't have evidence of reinfection. However, it's not guaranteed that it's going to be given 100% because only time will tell us. Okay. بالنسبة للhigh flow nasal cannula, إحنا it is an excellent way of giving oxygen. It's في interference. معلش في الصوت. في رقم واحد, it's giving, it's allowing you to give high FiO2 up to 100% guaranteed. It is very comfortable for the patients, and also it's generating PEEP, which is a type of CPAP. If you go at a rate of 60 liter per minute, you are guaranteeing a PEEP equal to 6 centimeters of water, which is good. However, on the other hand, the incidence of the spread, the reports are saying till now that there is no increased more than the others non-invasive. However, we have chosen in our hospital just because of logic that it's coming from in the nose and can be connected to the air. You don't have anywhere to put a filter, so we have decided to use the full face mask with double filter in one limb. But all the reports till now are showing that the incidence of spread, if the doctors looking after them and the nurses are doing the proper PPE, so the incidence of their infection is low.
ECMO.
الإكمو يعني I should be frank, in our hospital patients who are indicated for ECMO, we were referring to a tertiary center. We don't have ECMO in our hospital now.
Professor, I have a slight comment on ECMO. I haven't been involved personally in with ECMO patients, but it's a very limited resource even in the wealthiest health systems. So in our region, for example, there is only one hospital that can offer ECMO. It's a limited resource. Their data are not out yet, so we have to wait for their data. And if the learning curve actually is not catching up when you're doing large number of cases, the harm might outweigh the benefit, to be honest. So thinking about ECMO in the middle of a pandemic, I don't think it's realistic enough. And as regard high flow nasal cannulae, I requested it very recently in theater while waking up a massively obese patient, and it was declined for the same exact reason that Prof. Noaman said, the risk of infection, even if we were in theater in controlled environment.
Just about ECMO, ECMO has a role, as you and we have referred many patients and to the tertiary center from our hospital. The mortality rate is very high, and we've seen it's up to between 60% to 80%, depending on the centers. But some centers are better than others, and there are some. If you read the last ICNARC report, there are a good body of evidence about this, but personally, I don't have experience with it.
I would like to have a little bit comment here. Tackling COVID is not only doctor responsibility, it is a community and the government responsibility as well. And I remember here in Ireland, we are one of the most successful European model. We tackled COVID very early, and even the community, when the government said little bit warning, all the community acted immediately, even before the government acted, and even before any protocol or any hospital preparation. The cafe and the restaurant closed, and even before the lockdown. I believe the government here in Ireland locked down the country in appropriate time, and for almost 10 weeks, nobody would go outside the house except for walk or going to the hostel. And I understand there is a lot of issues about that and the socioeconomic status and people working daily and earning and all this stuff. It is all. But social distance is the most important factor for avoiding the virus. And we have a scene here. The virus is there. Don't go to the virus. Otherwise, the virus will not come to you. If you keep away from the virus will not come to you.
طيب في معلومة كده حد قالها دلوقتي وإحنا already كان في أستاذ عندنا في التروبيكال ريز الفكرة دي وإحنا بنعملها دلوقتي بحث في جامعة اسكندرية. ده طبعا عندنا احنا في اسكندرية لان UK ما بيستخدموش الهيدروكسيكلوروكين. كان فكرة البحث ايه؟ ان احنا نشوف العيانين اللي هم بتوع السيستميك لوبس وبتوع الروماتولوجي اللي هم اوريدي ماشيين بقالهم سنين على البلاكونيل او الهيدروكسيكلوروكين. هل الناس دول في منهم جالهم كوفيد ولا كلهم كانوا اميون كأنهم بياخدوا بروفلاكتيك دوز زي ما احنا كنا بنقول على الدكاتره؟ فكان في سؤال طلع دلوقتي وفي نفس الوقت زي ما بقول حاجه احنا لاحظنا الحكايه دي من الاستاذ التروبيكال واحنا ماشيين في البحث بنجمع الحاجات دي كلها. فهل في حد من حضراتكم عنده يعني اكسبلانيشن لكده ان الناس اللي كان ماشيين بقى لهم سنين على الهيدروكسيكلوروكين نتيجه مش كوفيد نتيجه يعني ديزيزز ثانيه بالذات هل جالهم كوفيد ولا كانوا اميون منه؟ في معلومات؟
والله احنا ما شفناش يا دكتور احمد لغايه دلوقتي يعني في بالنسبه لنا يعني في اللوكاليتي اللي انا فيها ما شفناش حالات كولاجين فاسكولار ماشيين على الكلوروكين جالهم. ما اعرفش دكتور جيهان او في المناطق الثانيه فيه ولا لا. لكن ده بالنسبه
انا برضو ما عنديش حالات ريكوردد، بس خد بالك احنا مش ما عندناش كل الداتا لكل الحالات برضو. بنتكلم في 35,000 عيان او اكتر دلوقتي، فعلشان ارد ان في او ما فيش لازم يبقى عندي ديفينيت داتا عنه.
احنا عملناها بقى بالعكس يا دكتوره جيهان، ان احنا كلمنا اساتذه الروماتولوجي كلهم وقلنا لهم ان كل واحد في عيادته او في الكليه كان بيتابع، احنا عايزين منه مثلا 30 حاله، ف30 وهم حوالي 15، يعني كده هنجمع حوالي 500 عيان اتليست في خلال اسبوع. قلنا لهم يشوفوا الناس دول، كل دكتور مع ال 30 حاله بتوعي يتصل بيهم بالتليفون ويقول لهم هل حد منهم راح مستشفى جاله فيفر، اتعمل له بي سي ار وطلع بوزيتيف ولا لا، وهنرد على حضراتكم بعد كده ان شاء الله.
اذر جاردنج الكونفرنسنت بلازما دكتور احمد اللي جاب عليه في المايلد ومودريت سيفير كيس اللي هم في الداخل الاي سي يو، وبتتاخد بدوز طبعا البريكوشن بتعمل زي البلاد ترانسفيوجن بالظبط، العيان بتعمل له كل الفايرال بانل عشان البريكوشن ما يكونش عنده اي ديزيز ده اتش اي في ولا هيباتايتس، وبتتاخد بدوز 4-5 ميلي جرام بير كيلو جرام بودي ويت، واخد بالك الوانس النتائج فعلا كويسه جدا.
طيب كان في من ضمن الاسئله البلازما تريتمنت،
ما هي الكونفرنسنت بلازما يعني بتتاخد من البيشنت اللي هو اوريدي كيورد وتعمل له البي سي ار وبروف ان هو العيان ده نيجاتيف، وبتعمل له انفستيجيشنز خلاص العيان ده شور انك تاخد منه بلازما.
وفي وقت محدد يا دكتور احمد مش كده؟ يعني بيقول أيوة ان انا بعمل له الكوانتيتيف اي جي جي ما بين 14 والبيست ان هو من 14 ل 28 يوم.
28 يوم
لو هو بي سي ار نيجاتيف،
بي سي ار نيجاتيف وهيباتيتس نيجاتيف واتش اي في نيجاتيف،
ايوه كل فعلا الفيروس بتاعه نيجاتيف ومفيش اي زي كانه بيتبرع بالدم بتاعه بالظبط.
لكن هو جهاز دلوقتي يا دكتور جهنم عارف الكلام ده، عندهم هم الاجهزه يعني احنا سمعناها في اجهزه بتفصل بلازما بس، يعني ما بياخدش بلاد وبعدين يفصل البلاد لوحده واللازما لوحدها. لا عندنا في مصر دلوقتي الاجهزه موجوده متوزعه في مناطق بحيث الجهاز يفصل بلازما فقط، يعني العيان بيتبرع ببلازما فقط.
والحاجه الجميله ان بيقولوا البلازما دي ممكن لمده سنه ان انا استخدمها في التريتمنت وانس ان انا
تسمح لي اعلق على الموضوع بقى. هي البلازما، هي البلازما بتطبق عندنا في الوزاره بقى دلوقتي حوالي شهر ونص شهرين ضمن كلينيكال ترايل. احنا بناخد كونفاليسنت بلازما من زي ما قلنا كيورت كورونا بيشنتس بعد اسبوعين مينيمم، اسبوعين من اسبوعين لثلاث اسابيع بعد الديشارج. وطبعا زي ما انتم حضراتكم قلتوا احنا بنشترط طبعا ان يتعمل له تاني بي سي ار ويكون نيجاتيف، ونتاكد ان العيان توتالي هيلد، ان هو ما فيهوش اي مانع من موانع التبرع بالدم الطبيعي اللي هي الفيروسات الاصابات الامراض المزمنه امراض القلب الى اخره، كانه هيتبرع بالدم تماما. البلازما بتسحب زي ما قلنا باجهزه معينه، بناخد البلازما بس. البلازما دي كل بيشنت بيقدر يتبرع ببلازما تغطي 2 بيشنتس، يعني كل دونر بيدي لاثنين بيشنتس، بيغطي 2 بيشنتس. احنا بنديها لكل عيان ب 2 وحدتين من البلازما، كل واحده من 200 ل 250 ملي، في ديستانس مسافه بينهم 12 ساعه. البلازما دي طبعا بتتاخد، ما بتبقاش بلازما بس، احنا بيتاخد يتقاس فيها نيترالايزنج انتي بودي تتر، واحنا بناخد سكور محدد عشان يبقى نيترالايزنج انتي بودي تتر نبقى متاكدين ان هي مفيده للعيان، وبيتقاس فيها الكوانتيتيف اي جي جي ليفل، وبتبقى حاجه من اتنين. لو هنقدر نقيس التتر ده وتقدر تتاخد، ممكن تتاخد خلال 24 ساعه من سحبها من الدونرز للبيشن. لو ما كانش بيتعمل حاجه اسمها شوك فريزنج انها تنزل لماينس 30 بسرعه وبتتجمد في ماينس 30، لما بتتجمد هي المفروض ممكن تبقى بريزيرفت اب تو 1 يير. لما بيجي بعد كده نستعملها العيان بتبقى سيود لما بتخرج عشان تفك، ولازم تتاخد في خلال ساعتين من ان هي بدايه عمليه الفك بتاعها دي. الدونر الريسيبيانت بقى والعيان اللي هيستلمها، احنا لغايه دلوقتي ريستريكتد. اولا كل الدراسات اتعملت على الحالات السيفير اللي امبنتنج ديفلوبينج اي ار دي اس، هم دول اللي بياخدوها. فاحنا لغايه دلوقتي عاملين البروتوكول على الحالات السيفير، اتجربت في بعض الحالات اكسبشنال كده في حالات ميكانيكالي فنتليتد. طبعا احنا لسه ما عندناش الداتا، لان احنا يعني بنجمع الداتا للحالات اللي اتاخدت بس، اكشوال النتائج كانت في الحالات السيفير اللي ما كانش على ميكانيكال فنتليشن او كان بتاعها كان كويس، نسب التحسن كانت عاليه. الحالات الميكانيكال فنتليشن يمكن ما كانتش نفس نسب التحسن، وده مقبول لان في بعض الاستاديز اللي اتعملت ان قالت ان ده ممكن يبقى مقبول في الحالات ديت ان يبقى فيهم نسبه فيريال مورتاليتي في حالات الميكانيكال فنتليشن، لكن احنا لسه طبعا في انتظار النتائج انها تطلع كام.
وفي just recently يا دكتور احمد كوكران ستادي just I think a couple of days ago، يمكن طبعا دكتوره جيهان شافتها، الكوكرين فالك ايتال طلعوا ان عملوا ريفيو لكل الاستاديز اللي اتعملت اند ذي دو نوت فيل الجروب اللي عمل الاستادي دي او الريفيو in there is strong evidence of the convalescent plasma. However, the studies which has been published, Lhumma, they are reporting on, they are the big study, the eighth study, Tamania, and all of them has shown that there is a positive effect of the plasma of the plasma from the convalescent patients. بس هم كان الحاجة اللي هم يعني بيقيموا حسابها إن أنت مش ما عملتش trial between two to compare. However, it's impossible. على فكرة مش أول مرة زي ما دكتور أحمد الجزار عارف إن مش أول مرة يستخدموا الكوفالنسنت بلازما في حالات الإنفلونزا. It has been used many times, but not one single study was done as a proper randomized study. It's because of practicality, it's impossible to do it. So all the evidence coming from all the studies so far, there is an improvement. However, the criticism was only because it was not done as a randomized study, which I believe it's impossible to do anyway.
يا دكتور سعد انا شايف فيها اسئله كتير بس يعني الوقت
I think it was we're overdue now and we are coming to disclose close our session. And on behalf of myself, I believe, and everybody, I would like to thank our great professors and the excellent speakers, Prof. Jehan Al-Assal, Prof. Ahmed Jazar, and Dr. Yasser Noaman from London, Dr. Mohamed Kulani from Manchester, and my excellent colleague and excellent professor, Dr. Ahmed Youssef, chest professor and head of the department in Alexandria University Hospital. I would like to thank the organizing company, VBL, and the event, and the sponsor, Mendray Company, and good evening to everybody.
Thank you.
Nice to see you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.